Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Tashfeen Ashraf from Gautam Buddha University. Today we are going to talk on module Collection and Purification Process of Recombinant Proteins under the paper Animal Cell Biotechnology. Regarding the learning objectives, in this presentation I would discuss the overview of how recombinant proteins are produced, and once produced, what measures are taken to extract the recombinant proteins. We would also talk about the characteristics of proteins that form the basis of purification of recombinant proteins, techniques used for purification, and identification and quantification. Finally, we would talk about methods employed to improve the yield and aid purification of recombinant proteins. Before coming on to recombinant proteins, let's recall that proteins are a class of biological macromolecules that perform diverse functions that mainly include repair and maintenance. Proteins also act as enzymes. As enzymes, they increase the rate of biochemical reactions. Many of the proteins, they work as hormones. One of the important hormones that are routinely produced via recombinant DNA technology is the hormone human insulin that is used to control diabetes. Proteins also act as antibodies. As antibodies, they neutralize and help in removal of antigens. Proteins are also involved in transport and storage of molecules. For instance, protein like hemoglobin is responsible for transport of oxygen from lungs to tissues. Another instance of transport is lipoproteins. Lipoproteins are a class of proteins that are involved in transport of different types of lipids. When excess proteins are taken by body, they are stored as fat, which is in times of need utilized as an energy source. So based on the diverse functions that are performed by different proteins, proteins are also referred to as the major effector molecules. Broadly, the function of proteins can be categorized as core functions and regulatory functions. Among the core functions of proteins are their role as enzymes for catalyzing various metabolic reactions that may include the metabolism of various biomacromolecules and conversion of molecules like DNA to RNA and then RNA to proteins. While in the case of regulatory roles, proteins are involved in regulation of processes like cell-to-cell communication, cell addition, cell division, development, and processes like signaling, etc. Let us now understand why do we need to produce recombinant proteins. As you know that proteins perform wide range of functions, so they have immense applications in areas like human nutrition, therapeutics, cosmetics, animal husbandry, etc. Now, for these wide range of applications, earlier people used to purify proteins from natural sources. But purification of proteins from natural source is often a time-consuming process, and also the yield is very less. While in case of production of proteins from recombinant DNA technology, large amount of desired protein can be synthesized in a short span of time. Some of the examples of important recombinant proteins that are routinely used include human insulin, interferon beta, human growth hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, and proteins like blood clotting factor 8. Recombinant proteins are proteins synthesized in vitro through the insertion of foreign gene in the host cell that is capable of synthesizing that gene and thereby leading to the synthesis of a fully functional and stable recombinant protein. Now, the steps that are involved in the production of recombinant proteins include the production of competent cells via insertion of vector into the host cells. Vector contains a gene of interest. When this vector along with the gene of interest, that is called insert, is transferred into the host cell, the host cells are said to be transformed. After the transformation, the selection of these transformants needs to be done. Now, for selection, generally the vector contains marker gene also along with the insert. These marker genes are normally genes for antibiotic resistance. So when a host cell that has been transformed using a vector that contains our target gene along with the gene for antibiotic resistance, now when this transformed host cell is grown into a medium containing the antibiotic, only the positive transformants would be growing in the medium, while other cells which have not taken up this vector, they would not grow. After this, the transformants are scaled up and they are grown in a medium that enables the host cells to synthesize the recombinant protein. After this synthesis, the recombinant proteins needs to be extracted from the medium or from inside the host cells and then purified for further use. Broadly speaking, host cells can be prokaryotic in nature or eukaryotic in nature. Prokaryotic hosts include bacteria, while eukaryotic hosts include organisms like yeast, mammalian cells, and plant cells, etc. Let us now discuss outline of how recombinant proteins are produced in host cells, for example, prokaryotic hosts like bacteria. For this, the gene of interest is first inserted into a suitable vector, that is the bacterial plasmid, and then the host cells are transformed by this modified vector, which has the desired gene of interest. These vectors also contain a marker gene that eventually helps us in identifying the host cells that have been transformed by this plasmid. The commonly used marker gene is the gene for antibiotic resistance. So, host cells that take up this vector, they would be able to grow in a medium containing antibiotic, while other cells who have not taken up this vector, they would not be able to grow in this medium. Once the host cells containing the vector have been selected, they are then grown in a culture that induces the host cells to express the gene. After the gene has been expressed and recombinant protein has been produced, it is extracted and then later purified. Regarding the purpose of extraction and purification, we know that every protein has a specific function. So before a recombinant protein could be used, it needs to be purified so that other contaminating molecules are removed. If the contaminations are present, they may hinder with the function of the recombinant protein. In the case of production of recombinant proteins in bacteria, a mass of aggregated protein is often formed, that is known as inclusion bodies. So before use, the recombinant protein needs to be purified or rather resolubilized from these inclusion bodies in a suitable solubilization buffer. After purification, recombinant proteins are structurally and functionally characterized, and only after that they are available for use. Once the recombinant protein has been synthesized by the host cell, the protein may either be retained within the cell, that means it could be an intracellular protein, or it may be secreted out in the periplasmic space or in the surrounding medium. Intracellular proteins may either be cytosolic or membrane bound. In the case of cytosolic proteins, which are largely hydrophilic, they may be extracted using aqueous buffer. While in the case of membranous proteins, their extraction and purification requires the need of suitable detergents for solubilization of plasma membrane. Before purification, the recombinant proteins needs to be extracted from the cells. And for the extraction, in case of intracellular recombinant proteins, it requires the disruption of the cell. Now, various physical methods are used for disruption of cells. The first method includes the use of blenders and grinders, which use strong shear forces to break open the cells. The next is the use of press, in which cells are passed through small orifice under high pressure. So as the cells emerge from orifice, pressure gets reduced and cells expand rapidly and burst. Sonication is another method in which high frequency sound waves are used to break open the cells. In certain cases, enzymes are also used. For example, in the case of gram-positive bacteria, the enzyme called lysozyme is used. This lysozyme cleaves the thick peptidoglycan layer of bacteria. If the recombinant protein is a membrane protein, then in such cases, non-ionic detergents need to be added to the extraction buffer. in order to permeabilize the cell membrane. In certain cases, for instance, in the case of gram-negative bacteria, EDTA is used to remove the calcium ions, because as the calcium ions are removed, it leads to the destabilization of the lipopolysaccharide layer. In certain cases, like extraction of proteins from yeast, enzymes like zymolase and lyticase are used, while in the case of extraction of proteins from filamentous fungi, the enzyme chitinase is often used. Cell disruption methods can be broadly classified into mechanical methods and non-mechanical methods. The mechanical methods that involve solid shear, liquid shear, or other ways of disrupting the cells. For solid shear, methods like bead milling and high-speed homogenization is used. For liquid shear, high-pressure homogenization and methods like ultrasonication is used. While in the case of other methods, microwaves are used for disrupting the host cells. While in certain cases, pulse electric field is used for breaking the cells. In the case of non-mechanical methods, the cells are lysed either by chemical means or by enzymatic methods. Preparation of extraction buffer. For effective extraction, appropriate buffer with suitable ionic strength and pH needs to be prepared. Generally, phosphate and trace buffers are used in the pH range of 7 to 8. These buffers are used at low ionic strength of a molarity of about 100 to 200 millimolars. In addition, extraction buffers also contain various other substances like antioxidants, substrates, enzyme inhibitors, cofactors, EDTA, and compounds like polyvinyl pyrrolidone that facilitate and aid the extraction of recombinant proteins. Under cellular conditions, proteins are under highly reducing environment, but during extraction and purification, they are exposed to oxidizing conditions. Therefore, in order to prevent this oxidation, antioxidants are added to extraction buffer. If the recombinant protein is an enzyme, the cofactors of the enzyme or its substrate may be added to the extraction buffer, which may help stabilize the enzyme and facilitates its activity determination during purification. When the extraction buffer needs to be used for extended periods, certain antibacterial or antifungal agents are added. One of the commonly used bacteriostatic agent that is added to extraction buffers is sodium azide. Substances like polyvinyl pyrrolidone is also added in the case of extraction of recombinant proteins from plant tissues. In order to minimize protein loss during extraction and purification, the entire process of extraction and purification is carried out at low temperature of around 4 degrees centigrade and in the presence of protease inhibitors. These protease inhibitors are used in order to inactivate the proteases, which during the extraction gets unpacked and may lead to the hydrolysis of the protein of interest. Commonly used protease inhibitors falls under following categories. They may either be serine protease inhibitors, thiol protease inhibitors, aspartic protease inhibitors, metalloprotease inhibitors, or exopeptidase inhibitors. Stability and solubility of a protein are two important criteria that form the basis of separation and purification in certain cases. If the protein of interest is stable at high temperatures and it is tolerant to extremes of pH, the contaminating proteins can be removed by adjusting the pH and temperature in such a way that our protein of interest remains stabilized and soluble, while other contaminating proteins or undesirable proteins are removed. Solubility is another important criteria. The property of differential solubility of proteins and solubility being affected by presence of different co-solvents is used in fractionating proteins before further purification. For instance, ammonium sulfate is a salt that is commonly used for fractionating proteins. At higher concentrations, ammonium sulfate leads to the salting out of proteins in gradual manner. This is known as salting out effect. So the proteins which are salted out or which gets precipitated they are then resolubilized for further purification. Following are four important attributes of proteins that are exploited for purification by different purification techniques. As we all know that charge on a protein depends on the amino acid composition as well as the pH of the surrounding medium. Depending upon the specific charge on the protein at a particular pH, they may be purified by ion exchange chromatography. Ion exchange chromatography uses resins that contain either cation exchangers or anion exchangers. Affinity of a protein for a specific ligand is again an important attribute that can be utilized for purification of a particular protein by affinity chromatography. In affinity chromatography, the ligand for the protein is immobilized on a suitable matrix. When the mixture of proteins containing the protein of interest is passed through this immobilized ligand, depending on the specificity and strong affinity for this ligand, the protein would bound to this immobilized ligand. Those proteins which have bound to this ligand non-specifically, they are removed during the later washing stages. Affinity chromatography is a very fast method. By using affinity chromatography, people have reported purification of certain proteins in a single step. The separation of proteins on the basis of molecular weight or size is utilized gel filtration chromatography. In gel filtration chromatography or molecular sieve chromatography, proteins of different sizes, they can be separated by passing them through a matrix with pores of definite size range. Those proteins which have size larger than the size range of pores, they pass through the exterior of the pores, while those proteins which lie within the whose size lies within the size range of pores, they pass both from the exterior of the pores as well as from the interior of the pores. So when the mobile phase is passed through the column of gel filtration chromatography, different proteins have different mobilities that depend on their size. The proteins which are larger in size, they are excluded from the column earlier than the proteins which are smaller in size. Hydrophobicity is another important criteria that is utilized for purification of recombinant proteins by hydrophobic interaction chromatography. As we have discussed earlier, that recombinant proteins, they may either be intracellular or they may be secreted out in the medium. If the protein is intracellular, the recombinant cell needs to be lysed for extraction and purification. While in case of secretory proteins, it is comparatively easier to purify them as compared to intracellular proteins. In case the sample contains high amount of fat, the sample should be defatted by using nonpolar solvent. But however, it should be noted that during this process, nonpolar proteins, they may get removed, and this may lead to a decrease in the yield of recombinant proteins. If the recombinant protein is an enzyme, during the extraction, the different fractions are analyzed for the presence of desired enzyme. In case of non-enzymatic proteins, and if the antibody against protein of interest is available, then the fraction containing recombinant protein can be identified by techniques like Western blotting or ELISA, that is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Chromatography is one of the important techniques that is used for purification of proteins. During chromatography, the separation depends on how the molecule fractionates itself when it is passed through two immiscible phases, the mobile phase and the stationary phase. Depending upon how much the protein fractionates itself into the stationary phase or mobile phase, it determines how fast the protein would be eluted out from the chromatography column. If the protein distributes itself more into mobile phase, its mobility would be faster, while if the protein fractionates itself more into stationary phase, its mobility would be less, and therefore it would be retained more into the chromatography column and eluted out later.
For purification of recombinant proteins, various chromatographic techniques are used.
In the case of gel filtration chromatography, separation is based on the basis of size or molecular weight of the protein. In ion exchange chromatography, separation is based on the net charge on the protein at particular pH and also on the charge density and charge distribution. In hydrophobic interaction chromatography, separation is accomplished by exploiting the interaction between hydrophobic regions on protein surface with the matrix. Once the protein gets bound to the matrix, it is eluted by changing the polarity of the solvent. In the case of affinity chromatography, strong affinity between the protein of interest and its ligand is exploited for separation. In the case of covalent chromatography, unlike other methods discussed, covalent chromatography involves covalent binding between the protein and the matrix. The matrix used has bound molecules capable of forming disulfide bond with the free thiol groups of the protein. Recombinant proteins containing free thiol groups have been purified using this method. This figure gives a overview of different types of chromatographies that are commonly used. We have affinity chromatography, hydrophobic interaction chromatography, anion exchange chromatography, cation exchange chromatography, chromatofocusing, and then size exclusion chromatography. In case of affinity, hydrophobic interaction, anion exchange, cation exchange, and chromatofocusing, the separation is via adsorption of protein of interest to our matrix. While in case of size exclusion chromatography, separation is via differential mobility in solution when the solution containing the protein of interest is passed through size exchange chromatography column. In case of affinity chromatography, the separation is through ligand binding, while in case of hydrophobic interaction chromatography, the hydrophobic effects play an important role for interaction of ligand with our protein of interest. In the case of anion exchange and cation exchange chromatography, Coulombic interactions between the exchangers, ion exchangers which are present on the column, and between the protein that is present in the mixture are responsible for separation. While in case of chromatofocusing, the separation is on the basis of isoelectric point. And as discussed earlier, the separation in case of gel filtration chromatography is on the basis of size of the protein. There are various advantages and disadvantages that are associated with different chromatographic procedures. Depending upon the availability of resources and the resolution and the level of purity that is desired, different chromatographic techniques that are used have different resolution. So depending upon to what level of purity the desired protein is required, it helps us in selecting the chromatographic technique for separation. Electrophoresis is another important technique that is commonly used for separation and identification of proteins. During electrophoresis, the protein molecules are made to move under the influence of electric field. For this, polyacrylamide gels are used that provide porous medium through which proteins move toward their respective electrode, with mobility determined by their net charge and or size. Two commonly used types of electrophoresis are native phage and SDS phage. In native phage, the proteins are electrophoresed under conditions that maintain those proteins in their native state, and therefore the proteins get separated based on their mobility determined by their net charge. In the case of SDS phage, the separation is performed under denaturing conditions in the presence of detergents like sodium nodicyl sulfate. This detergent uniformly binds to protein and imparts a negative charge. On an average, one molecule of sodium nodicyl sulfate binds every two amino acid residues. In case of SDS phage, proteins get separated on the basis of size. Once the proteins are separated through electrophoresis, they are transferred from gel to the nitrocellulose membrane during the process called Western blotting. During Western blotting, the proteins are adsorbed on the membrane. Once adsorbed, the protein of interest can then be identified. If the fluorescent antibodies against the protein of interest are available, the protein can be identified by incubating the nitrocellulose membrane with the fluorescent antibodies. There are various immunological methods available to quantify proteins. If the antibodies against the recombinant protein are available, then quantification of protein can be done by the technique known as enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, that is ELISA. There are various types of ELISAs available. And in case of sandwich ELISA, the antibody against the protein of interest is immobilized on a suitable support and is then incubated with the fraction to be screened. If the fraction contains the protein of interest, it binds to the immobilized antibody. Non-specifically bound proteins, they are later removed during washing stage. The bound protein then traps the secondary antibody, which is enzyme labeled. After the washing procedure, if the substrate for the enzyme is added, its conversion to a colored product helps in the quantification of protein. For quantification, ELISA is performed by using standards with known concentration of proteins. So a dose response curve is plotted by using standards with known concentration of protein, and the concentration of protein in the fraction is then known by reading the intensity of color developed on that standard curve. Various strategies are used to facilitate purification of recombinant proteins, and which also enhance the yield of recombinant protein. As we have discussed earlier, that secretory proteins are easy to purify as they are secreted in the medium or in the periplasmic space by the host cells. As major objective of the extraction is to attain high yield of recombinant proteins, ensuring the secretion of recombinant protein prevents its degradation by intracellular hydrolytic enzymes. Also, if the recombinant protein is secreted, it prevents the host cell from the toxicity of recombinant proteins, as certain proteins are toxic to the host cell. Another important method that facilitates the purification is by synthesizing the recombinant protein as fusion proteins. For fusion protein, the target gene is joined to another gene. This attached protein or tag is selected and or designed in such a way that it facilitates the purification and is easily removed either chemically or enzymatically after the purification. One of the commonly used tag is the enzyme glutathione reductase. During fusion proteins containing glutathione reductase, the gene of interest is ligated with the gene for glutathione reductase through a suitable linker region. Once the recombinant proteins is synthesized along with the glutathione reductase as a fusion protein, it can be purified by affinity chromatography on a column containing immobilized glutathione. So in this way, it ensures very fast purification of fusion protein containing glutathione reductase. After the purification, the glutathione can be suitably removed either enzymatically or chemically.
So students, let's now summarize what we have learned in this module. We have discussed various commonly used techniques and reagents used to extract and purify recombinant proteins. We have also discussed the outline of fusion proteins and how fusion proteins aid in purification and extraction. We have also discussed about the importance of secretory proteins that facilitate the extraction and purification of recombinant proteins. The presentation provides information that is important for successful extraction and purification of recombinant proteins. I'm sure you must have enjoyed the presentation. For future communication, I would request you to connect with me on the given email ID. Thank you very much.